What if there was a way to desalinate water with absolutely no waste? And what if in the process you could generate clean 24/7 electricity, killing three birds with one stone? The biggest challenge in turning seawater into freshwater isn't just getting the salt out, it's what you do with the toxic hypersaline brine that gets left behind, which is an environmental nightmare. I was recently sent a blueprint, an engineering plan out of Australia for a new type of utility. The company's claims were so audacious that even if half of them were true, it would be game changing. So today, we're gonna pull back the curtain, run the numbers for ourselves, and see if this truly is the future of desalination. Let's figure this out together. I'm Ricky, and this is Tuba Da Vinci. This video is brought to you by EcoFlow. The company I'm talking about is called Soul Desal Australia. According to their own diagrams, the process is beautifully simple. They use concentrated sunlight to heat and boil seawater, generating high temperature steam. The steam powers the turbine to make electricity. Then the same steam is condensed back into distilled, desalinated, pure fresh water. And here's the kicker. The leftover brine is sent to a crystallizer and turned into salt instead of pumping it back into the ocean. Simple, elegant, and obvious. Only two things go in, seawater and solar energy. And three valuable things come out: clean drinking water, electricity, and salt. No emissions, no waste, only benefits. The system is scalable. They claim zero input cost and are in the process of patenting their technology. But it's their specific claims on the economics that are truly staggering. Let's start with number one, cheap baseload power. Soul Desal claims they'll be able to sell electricity at $100 per megawatt hour. That's roughly 75% cheaper than baseload from a diesel plant, cheaper than coal, and cost competitive with renewables. The critical difference is that Soul Desal systems use thermal energy storage. These systems can store thermal energy at hundreds of degrees for days and even months with minimal losses, only around 1 degree Celsius per day. They can also dispatch energy on demand, turning it into a 24/7 baseload power source, something intermittent renewables have a hard time doing. For a remote location, town, or industrial site, their proposed 50 megawatt plant is a complete game changer. Next is desalinated water. A single 50 megawatt plant is projected to produce 1.72 million US gallons of desalinated water per day, enough for around 40,000 people at the global average, or about 20,000 Americans. Now, our viewers from outside the US were quick to point out just how much water us Americans use, between 80 to 100 gallons per day, but it is what it is. So, Soul Desal claims they'll produce the world's cheapest water. Their target is just $1.50 per cubic meter, or about $6 per 1,000 gallons. Let's put that into perspective. Here in San Diego, we pay between $9 and $13 per 1,000 gallons. So Soul Desal's water would be 36 to 55% cheaper than what we pay here. But California is notorious for low water costs. No, I'm just kidding. It's really high. The US average is a bit lower, usually around $8 per 1,000 gallons. Now, in Australia, where energy and labor costs are high, a typical reverse osmosis or RO plant produces water for around $3.50 per cubic meter. Soul Desal claims they can do it for half that price. They even claim to undercut the world's cheapest producers in Saudi Arabia, who come in around $2 per cubic meter. And we'll get back to that in a minute because there's more to it than that. Finally, there's their claim of producing solar salt with zero waste. This is where their business model gets really clever. They claim 0% waste cost. By crystallizing the brine instead of dumping it, they don't just create a third revenue stream. They get rid of the most notorious waste coming from all desalination plants in the world. Beyond the environmental benefit, what they're really trying to pull off here is to bypass years of costly and complex environmental regulations. For any big infrastructure project, getting approvals can be a nightmare. I remember a few years ago when the large $1.4 billion Poseidon water desalination plant proposed for Huntington Beach, California, was rejected by the California Coastal Commission on environmental grounds. Soul Desal is positioning their zero waste approach, which in the industry is called zero liquid discharge, as a fast lane to get the plant built, reducing their capital expenditure and time to market. So that's the what. Now let's look at how this actually works. At first glance, the engineering and the synergy is genius. It got me hooked as soon as I heard about it. The biggest cost in thermal desalination is the energy to boil water. It's a massive amount of energy, and most of that input energy goes back out because you have to cool the steam down to condense the pure water. Now, what I found out is that in a normal steam turbine, there's a large and expensive condenser unit that runs cold water, usually from a river, through heat exchangers to condense the steam back into liquid water where it's fed back into the boilers in a closed loop. And to increase the vacuum in the turbine's outlet, which increases thermal efficiency. Fresh water and electricity are resources that we take for granted, but they're vital to everything in our lives. It's why we take energy security so seriously, and it's why we love the latest Series 3 energy storage solutions from EcoFlow. The Delta 3 Max Plus is my go-to for everyday peace of mind. It's a 2 kilowatt-hour beast that outputs 3,000 watts, enough to run my fridge, lights, router, and kitchen appliances simultaneously during an outage. With XBoost technology, it pushes up to 3,800 watts and charges from 0 to 80% in just 64 minutes, and it's whisper quiet. If you need even more power, the Delta 3 Ultra Plus packs 3 kilowatt hours of energy storage, 3,600 watts of power output, and 7,200 watt surge capacity. It handles literally everything, and it's got 11 output ports, including an RV-ready TT30 connector and 140-watt USB-C for laptops. Both batteries have dual solar inputs, 1,000 watts total for the Max Plus, and 1,600 watts for the Ultra Plus. Both Plus systems have smart output priority. That means through the app, I can tell my Deltas which devices matter most, like keeping my fridge running or my NAS online, and it'll prioritize those automatically if the battery runs low. And Storm Guard mode is a game changer. The system monitors weather alerts and pre-charges itself before a storm even hits. They're also expandable with smart extra batteries up to 10 kilowatts for the Max Plus and 11 for the Ultra Plus. Whether you need power for outdoor adventures, a few hours of backup, or days of off-grid power, EcoFlow's comprehensive Delta 3 series has you covered. Use my links in the description for the best deals and check them out for yourself today. Huge thanks to EcoFlow and you. Now back to the show. So, Sol Desal's genius idea was to first generate high-pressure steam directly from seawater with a source of free energy, the sun. Second, to use that steam for high-value work of spinning a turbine to generate cheap electricity. Third, and this is the critical part, instead of rerouting the pure condensed water back into a boiler, simply break the turbine's closed-loop water cycle to capture it as a second product, fresh water. Instead of throwing the steam's leftover energy away in a cooling tower, use it as preheat to input salt water before it reaches the boiler, recovering all the latent heat from the steam that would have otherwise been lost to the surroundings. But of course, we are continuing to feed seawater into a boiler and extracting fresh water, so we're going to have a concentrated brine. The last step is to take the brine into a crystallizer and turn it into salt. This seems so perfect and obvious. The potential for technology like this is enormous. The UN estimates over 2 billion people currently live in water-stressed countries. What if we could use this kind of technology to provide fresh, clean drinking water for a quarter of them, say 500 million people? The regions of the world with the highest levels of solar energy, what we call the Sun Belt, are almost perfectly correlated with the regions facing the most severe water stress. We're talking about the Middle East, North Africa, southwestern United States, parts of South America like Chile, and of course, Australia. This is where billions of people live, and where water scarcity is already a source of economic and political tension. Just a few days ago, Ethiopia inaugurated its Grand Ethiopian Renaissance Dam on the Nile River, which intensified long-standing tensions with downstream nations Egypt and Sudan, who rely heavily on the Nile and fear a dam will restrict their water supply. So then the obvious question is, if this is so simple and brilliant, why haven't we been doing this for decades? So I looked into this and I did a lot of research to try to see if anyone had tried this, and I couldn't find any examples. And it's not because they haven't tried. The problem is that desalination is hard. The gist of the problem is that desalination isn't really a water problem. It's an energy problem. Separating salt from water is fundamentally hard to do. It's like trying to unmix cream from your coffee. We've covered desalination several times on this channel, and we will continue to do so because I think water is going to be a very important part of the future. So we'll put links in the description and in the cards where you can see those other videos. But before we get back to that, there's something I found worrying about the idea of producing and selling salt as a byproduct. A single Sol Desal plant is projected to make 6.5 million liters of fresh water daily while generating 50 megawatts of power and 165 tons of salt. This would supply a minimum level of water security for 130,000 people. To supply water for 500 million people, we'd need 3,800 Sol Desal plants. The co-generated electricity output would be staggering. You'd be producing over 190 megawatts of clean 24/7 baseload power. That's almost 6% of the entire global electricity demand. But you'd also be producing over 229 million tons of salt every single year. And this reveals a paradox. Australia is already the seventh largest exporter of salt in the world, producing around 12 million tons a year. The entire global market for sea salt is around 300 million tons. If a technology like Sol Desal were adopted globally to solve our water problem, the salt byproduct would nearly double the world's supply overnight. And this gets to the heart of something really important. The real value of the salt isn't as a commodity to be sold. The real value is simply in not being brine. The profit comes from achieving zero liquid discharge and avoiding the environmental and regulatory costs of waste. The salt itself is just a bonus. But remember, we made a video about the future of sodium ion batteries, and this is where this can change things. If they co-located Sol Desal plants near locations with massive demands for future sodium supply to meet the expected growth of sodium ion batteries, this could be a game changer. It's hard to know what materials will be valuable. Things like iron, we know will always be valuable. Fossil fuels, no one knew how valuable that would be, and we can see how this last 100 years played out. And now we're looking at new thing, lithium. Lithium prices have soared, and now sodium might be next. But the good news for sodium is we have a ton of it. So that's the pitch. Pure fresh water from the sun, and the byproducts are electricity, salt, and fresh water. That's the story. But of course, our job is to dig deeper and to really get to the bottom and the context. Most research into combining CSP and desalination hooks a thermal desalination unit to the turbine's low-grade waste heat. It sounds efficient, but in practice, it's like putting a kink in a car's exhaust pipe. It creates back pressure on the turbine, which kills its efficiency, which completely destroys the economics by raising the cost of electricity by over 33%, not counting the extra revenue from water. This is why many engineers argue it's just cheaper and more efficient to build a field of solar panels and use that electricity to run a standard reverse osmosis plant. But Sol Desal's process is different. They're not using waste heat. They're using the main high-quality steam to run the turbine, and then simply condensing it into water. It's a much more direct and seemingly more efficient path and avoids the back pressure problems. But even this more elegant process can't escape the energy vampire of crystallization. So you'd think you'd only need another 2,133 joules to get the rest out. But that's not how thermodynamics work. It actually takes 12,153 joules, almost six times more energy, to get the remaining 465 liters of water still present in the leftover brine. That's a massive internal tax on the electricity the plant can sell to the grid. But even if you can make all the energy and financial math work, there's still a single show-stopping reason why this obvious solution hasn't been done before. The one detail that makes this whole process go from simple to borderline impossible. You can't just boil seawater and run a turbine with the steam. There's a simple reason the steam turbine works in a loop of pure water. If you boil seawater, you get steam. Steam is just water, right? Well, yeah, that's true. But there's something called the brine carryover effect. When seawater boils, it splashes and creates tiny little droplets of brine in the air that are carried by the steam. These tiny salt particles would act like a sandblaster, slowly pitting and destroying those blades. The salt would also deposit and form on the surface, throwing the balance of the entire multi-ton rotor out of sync, leading to vibrations that could tear the machine apart. Which brings us to the billion-dollar question that this entire venture rests on. How has Sol Desal solved this problem? Or has it been solved? How are they creating turbine-grade steam from raw corrosive seawater? According to the team, their technology is currently at a technology readiness level of 5, which means that it's at a technology demonstration level in a lab or a simulated environment. It's a long way from a full-scale commercially operating plant. We reached out and spoke to their founders, and they've already filed for an international patent and are currently working on their minimum viable product, which doesn't use solar yet, but burns oil. And from an engineering standpoint, that is a good way forward. Separate these different systems, prove one out first, and then continually build block by block. But it also shows that there's a long way to go to bring all this together. I'll be honest, making this video, when I came across this topic in Sol Desal, I kind of wanted to start trying to make one myself. It really is brilliant, but there are going to be challenges. And I think when you start to see how hard it is to desalinate water, it's not just the engineering challenge, it's the economics. If you can produce desalinated water, but it costs thousands and thousands of dollars per cubic meter, it's not going to be cost competitive. And the biggest irony and paradox of this whole story is that right now we have cheap fresh water, right? Which makes it really difficult to be commercially viable with a new technology like this. But one day when the water starts running out and the prices start to skyrocket, it would have been too late if we don't make these kinds of investments. But what I love about Sol Desal is they understand how difficult it is to make cheap fresh water. So by making electricity as well, they can kind of subsidize their own cost of water or vice versa. And then there's also salt and sodium ion batteries coming online. If they can make this work, it could be absolutely game-changing, and we can bring the economics down. It's in a lot of ways like the sodium ion battery. It's doing something that we know and love, but doing it with a new material, sodium, which is way more abundant, right? This is fresh water, which we all need, but to make fresh water takes so much energy. How do we go from needing energy to producing energy with something like this? So keep an eye out. We'll do a follow-up. Maybe we'll meet with them and go to Australia and check out their plant when they have more ideas. But this is one of those win-win-win situations that I freaking love. And who knows, maybe Juan and I will try to build in our backyard and make some videos about it. But it's fascinating stuff. As always, thank you for watching. And until next week, check out this video, which we think you'll also love. I'm Ricky with Tuba Da Vinci. Thank you so much for watching.